Let me start off by saying good evening and welcome you out to our Wednesday evening service at Mountaineer Missionary Baptist Church. Going over our announcements for this week, Sunday morning at 10:30, we'll be back on YouTube and Facebook, streaming our services. We'll be looking at our Sunday School quarterly lesson on Sunday morning at 10:30, and Sunday evening at 7, we'll have evening worship. We'll be preaching through the book of Romans chapter 9 on Sunday evening. We're also going to have special singing on Sunday. Sister Carly Miller is going to be singing for us. We'll be much in prayer for those services as they're upcoming. Today, we are blessed to have a wonderful friend of mine and a great sister in the Lord. Juilanna Santos is going to be blessing us with song.
In prisoner's chains, with bleeding stripes, Paul and Silas prayed that night, and in their pain began their chains were loosed, and they were free. I bless your name, I bless your name, I give you
Sister Juilanna and the blessing she gave us in music this evening. We're going to be in the book of Romans chapter 8, this evening, Romans 8:35. And we're going to be preaching the verses 35 through 39. That's Romans 8:35 through 39. So we get into God's word this evening. The Bible says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Most kind and gracious Heavenly Father God, Lord, we thank you for the blessing, the opportunity to be able to bring your word along social media this evening, Lord. We pray, Lord, as your word goes out, Lord, that it will touch the hearts of all that are hearing it, Lord, and that as your word promises that we know it will not return void. We pray, Lord, the church will be edified. We pray, Lord, for the unsaved soul that may be listening, Lord. We pray, Lord, that it would bring a Holy Spirit power of conviction upon their lives, and they would surrender their lives to you and be saved before it is everlasting too late. Lord, we pray, Lord, that you be with our world and our nation and local leaders as they make decisions that are important, that impact our world with this coronavirus issue, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you would give them the godly wisdom that they need. We pray, Lord, for all those who are sick and afflicted, Lord, that you would give them a healing touch. For all those that are working, that you'd give them safety, Lord. And we pray, Lord, that you would just heal our land, heal our nation, Lord, and help us grow closer to you, Lord, in everything that we go through. Lord, we love you. We thank you. We praise you for everything. We pray you forgive us for the times we sin and fall short. And give us the Holy Spirit anointing from on high that we may preach your word in truth. We love you and praise you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. And amen. All right, let's look at the message tonight. The message is titled, God's Unfailing Love. And I think if we would want to be honest, the most tough, mean individual in the world is still desiring love. We have a natural, inborn quality that gives us this desire to have love, to have fellowship with other individuals. That's one reason this quarantine has been so tough on so many people. It's not just because they miss going out to eat, or they miss going to the mall or to the ball games. It's because they miss people. They miss being around the ones that they love the most. Sunday, this coming Sunday being Mother's Day, I'll go ahead and say Happy Mother's Day early to all our mothers. But a lot of people are going to spend time without their mom on this Mother's Day. And that's going to be painful for a lot of individuals because they're missing out on an important part of God's plan for humankind, and that is God's plan of love. Now, the problem we have in America today and in the world, I believe, is we have a really weird definition of love, or what we think that love is. In fact, there's an old country song, looking for love in all the wrong places. There's a lot of people that are looking for love in definitely all the wrong places. They view lust as being love, or they view love as being what you can get or gain from a relationship. Well, we look at the love as Jesus describes it, or as Jesus lays it out, as a sacrificial love. It is not about what you get or how you increase your value because of another individual or another item. It is simply an inseparable emotional desire. We see that a lot of times in society that human love fails. We see divorces. We see children who don't have anything to do with their parents or their grandparents. We see mothers and fathers who are abusive or neglectful to their own children, and on and on and on. And we see these things that people are wanting to call it love, but these are not true love. But the Bible tells us that God is love. And we see here in Romans 8 that God's love also never fails. God's love never fails. You see, Paul's focus in these verses that we're looking at is not our love for Christ, but it's Christ's love for us. Because our love for Christ will fail sometimes. Now, we may not vocally say that, and we may not mentally even acknowledge that or admit it to ourselves, but every time that you choose something over God, your love for Christ is failing. When you turn off the message to watch a worldly program, your love for God is failing. When you close your Bible to read some sort of literature that is not Bible-centered, your love for God is failing. When you choose sin over God, your love for God is failing. When you choose fear over faith, your love for God is failing. But yet God's love for us never fails. This is important because our love for Christ is based on His love for us. If we did not have God loving us to start with, we would never even have interest in God. 1 John 4:19 says, we love Him because He first loved us. So the only reason that we love God is because God loves us and He draws us to Him by that working of the Holy Spirit of God. When we think about relationships, if you're married, your husband or your wife or your boyfriend or girlfriend, whichever, before you got to this covenant relationship in marriage, one partner had to do something to attract the other. The Hollywood movies, people show up, they look at each other, and you know, the birds sing, skies open up, sun shines, everything is just love at first sight, but typically that's not how it works in reality. We have one individual that will seek or desire out the other individual, and through a series of courtships and romances and things of that nature, that relationship grows and solidifies and becomes a covenant marriage bond. In the relationship with God, it is no different. But you are not the one who sought out God. You are not the one who loved God first. But because of God's unfailing love for you and the Holy Spirit opening your eyes to that, you begin to be receptive to the Word of God. And the Word of God took root in your heart, grew into a faith. And that faith became justification and on and on and on. But your love, your emotions toward God started with God, not with you. You see, we cannot make our present state of comfort an indicator for God's love, as Paul's bearing out here. A lot of people think that when life is good, God is just in love with them and He is blessing them. In fact, if you watch a lot of the TV guys out there, and I mean, there's probably even some churches that locally maybe that do this, I don't know, but there's this theology called the prosperity gospel, and it is not true. There's nothing true about it. And the basic theology behind the prosperity gospel, it says that if you are really in line with God, if you're in the side of the will of God, you're operating in faith, God will keep you healthy, wealthy, and wise. But the reality is that's not what the Bible teaches us about our relationship with God. In fact, Paul gives us a list of things he himself went through, yet he is certain that God loves him. See, when we read these last few verses here in Romans chapter 8, what we are seeing is the fact that Paul is coming to a sort of a climax in his letter here to the book of Romans, where he's talked about all these things, the spiritual battles and everything that the church goes through, Christians go through. But even though they go through all of these things, Paul is undoubtedly certain about this love that goes beyond all understanding, goes beyond what human mind can even comprehend. You see, God deals with His adopted sons the same way He dealt with His biological son. Now, if we look at the story of Jesus through the picture of the Gospels, we see Jesus didn't go around healthy, wealthy, and wise. Jesus suffered. Jesus was homeless at times. He was nomadic. In other words, He traveled around from place to place. People gave Him places to stay. They supported His ministry. But Jesus Himself was not wealthy. We don't know much about the health of Jesus, but what we do know, the Bible says He was very plain. In other words, He wasn't this big, gorgeous guy. He was plain, ordinary-looking individual. And we also see that He suffered. John 16:33, Jesus said, "These things I have spoken unto you, that in Me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation. But be of good cheer, I have overcome the world." So we see that Jesus has overcome the world. Because Jesus has overcome the world, we have overcome the world through Him. But we also see that we will suffer in our flesh, because that is the way that Jesus lived. Jesus suffered in His flesh. So because Jesus suffered, we are in Jesus, we are going to suffer as well. In fact, if you're living a Christian life that doesn't involve some suffering, you may not be walking much in the faith. And I don't say that to question anyone's relationship with God, but what I do say is the more it seems that you step out in faith to serve God, the more the devil is going to go on the attack and use all kinds of different things to try to destroy you. This is what Paul says. Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23, Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more in labors, more abundant in stripes above measure, in prison more frequent, in deaths often. Of the Jews, 5 times received I 40 stripes, save one. Thrice I was beaten with rods, once I was stoned, thrice I was suffer shipwreck. A night and a day I have been in the deep, in the journeys often in perils of water, in perils of robbers, in perils by my own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and painfulings, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst and fastings, often in cold and naked. Besides those things that are without, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all the churches. So we see that Paul went through more than I think anyone I know has done for their faith. But again, Paul doesn't go through that and say, well, God must not love me because he's making me suffer through an awful lot. But Paul counts it a joy to know that he is suffering, but he's not suffering for him. He's suffering for the cause of Christ, as we all must do. Not being able to gather in church may not seem like a real large hardship to some, but it is a suffering. In fact, through the suffering, I think we'll become stronger, because when it becomes safe again, we begin gathering together as brothers and sisters, and some are already gathered. We're going to hold off a little bit here at Mountaineer. But as we get back together, man, how wonderful and awesome it's going to be to be able to gather back together as believers in a local body and be able to shake hands and be able to fellowship, because this virus God has eliminated through his work and his sovereignty, and we can celebrate. But right now we are suffering, but that suffering drives a hunger up for the church, for the local assembly. You see, just like for me, you know, certain foods I like, when I go without those foods for a long period of time, I'll give you an example. Anyone that knows me very well knows my favorite food on the face of the earth is chicken livers. And that may seem really odd to a lot of you out there, but I love chicken livers and mustard greens, or kale greens. As long as it's greens, I don't even care. Mixed greens, whatever. Collard greens, it's all good. But chicken livers and greens and some cornbread, to me, that is just heaven on earth. But right now, you can't find chicken livers, and I don't know the reason behind that, but I have been looking everywhere for some chicken livers. And I have a hunger for chicken livers because I've not had it in a really, really, really long time. So that hunger is growing in me. When you go without something, the hunger grows. When you go without your local assembly, your hunger grows for church and fellowship. When you go without any sort of these things that God blesses us with, our hunger grows. So while we're suffering now, God is going to take this suffering, and it's going to be used for the glory of God and the spread of the gospel as people come back together again. You see, not only that, but people right now that may never be willing to attend church, may not be able to attend church, are possibly getting more church at home, sitting on the couch on Facebook or YouTube or whatever, by watching these church services, these streams, that maybe they've never gotten before. See, it's suffering, but God is using it for his glory. Now, if all this suffering does not disprove the prosperity gospel, I'm really unsure what does. So all these folks on TV that are saying, send me $1 million and I'm going to heal so-and-so or do this or do that. Listen, don't fall for that garbage. Those are charlatans that are taking advantage of you. That's not to say you shouldn't give, you shouldn't tithe, you shouldn't support ministry. But what that is saying is we do that with no expectations. We don't do that as a credit system that we're paying in that God may pour out. We're doing it out of the Bible says, a joyful heart to give unto the Lord. When you give to your local assembly, when you give to local ministries, and a lot of people get hung up on this 10% number. Listen, if you stop at 10% and say, well, I hit 10%, I'm good. That's not what God's goal is here. God's goal is to give with a joyful heart. We should give as God gives unto us. When we're in a season of life and God is pouring out blessings, and we are doing financially better, we ought to give a little bit better. And when God is, you know, when something happens and we're in a time of maybe famine, that we can't pour out quite as much. God doesn't desire you to harm your family by giving, but he desires to give. Now, that is a sign of your love for God, because you are doing something, not out of an obligation, but out of a love for God that you may give unto him. We see in verse 36... that Paul quotes Psalm 44:22, where he says,
that, let's read it here. As is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long, we are counted sheep for the slaughter. And as Paul is quoting this, he is identifying with Christ and Christ's sufferings. In other words, Paul is saying, listen, God, I know you love me. I know I'm going to go through a lot of things in this life. I know I'm going to suffer. And I want you to think of your own self as we preach this message this evening. If you had to go through shipwreck and famine and being beaten with rods and facing death at the sword and being in prison, would you still stand faithful to God? That's a tough question. And we are so abundantly blessed in America, and people want to pretend we're persecuted in our country. We're not persecuted in America. There's brothers and sisters overseas dying just to gather in a basement with a stark light bulb and try to teach through the Bible. When we're able, even when we can't meet due to safety, we can preach over social media, and it's encouraged to preach over social media. We don't have to worry about elected leaders threatening to shoot us because we carry a Bible around like they do in some foreign countries. So we need to praise God for our liberties. But the liberties we have, a lot of times, makes us really, sort of when we start to suffer, it bothers us a whole lot more. When overseas, when they suffer for the cause of the gospel, it really don't faze them a whole lot because they expect that. But we have the least little hiccup, and people get really upset and really tore up, and they want to start talking about how they're revolutionaries and rebels for the gospel when they're not. We're just going through what we should expect to go through from time to time. Bible never says that because you get saved, you're going to be popular. Bible never says because you get saved, people want to love you a whole lot more. In fact, the Bible says because you get saved, you're going to probably be more hated. You're going to be persecuted. You're going to suffer more. Now, they don't tell you that at invitations most of the time because people love to say, if God's got a plan for your life, submit your life to Him. God's going to pour blessings out upon you and all this great stuff. And God blesses you in so many ways, but our hope is not in this world. Our hope is in the world to come. In fact, again, God says we will suffer for the sake of Christ, possibly unto death. Now, we need to take them, count the cost. And I'm not trying to scare you away from salvation. I'm trying to give you an honest picture of salvation. Because what we do is we talk about how awesome the Christian life is and how it's just a field of roses and all this stuff. And then we take that prayer request in church services and people talk about all these horrible things that are happening in their life and they cry and they wail. And people who are lost hear that and they're so confused because we just told them that life is a field of roses and then also we just show them how miserable we are. Folks, life doesn't get easy. Not even because you're saved. You have someone to turn to. You have a strength in the Lord you didn't have before. You have a friend that stays closer than a brother. You have someone that goes with you all the way. But what we also have is the assurity in Christ that we will never be separated from God and that even if we die by the sword for the sake of the gospel, that we will go to be with Him in heaven. You see, He doesn't say we'll live forever, but He says not physically, but He says we will live forever in Christ. See, Paul tells us in verse 37 that in spite of all these things, we're more than conquerors, not through us, but through Christ Jesus. Now, that more than conquerors, again, that more than conquerors doesn't mean health, wealth, and prosperity. That means we've overcome death, hell, and the grave. That means if you place your faith in Jesus Christ and call on to Him for salvation, He will save you. And because He has saved you, there is nothing the world can throw against you that will overcome you. Because even if the worst thing the world can do is kill you. That is the very worst thing that it can do. But the Bible talks about not fearing those who can harm your flesh, but to fear that can harm your soul. You see, the reality is we are all going to die, or we're all going to leave this world if Christ returns, one way or the other. This is all temporary. But the soul is eternal. So while we fear so much the things that can harm our flesh, and we shouldn't live ignorantly. God has given us a good common sense. We ought to do the things that make good common sense. For example, I know that if I die, I'm going to go to heaven. But I'm not going to pull out of this parking lot and go down through hard at 110 miles per hour and plow into a hillside and kill myself. That would be very ignorant. I'm not going to go around picking up poisonous snakes thinking, well, God may protect me. Yes, He might, or I might get bitten and die. I'm not going to take up all kinds of bad habits that may shorten my life. I try to eat healthy. Because it's good common sense things. This is the tabernacle of the Holy Spirit of God. I want to take care of it. We're encouraged to take care of it. And that means not living haphazardly and just welcoming and into death. That means using good God-given common sense. That wasn't part of the message, but I'll throw that in for free. See, Paul says, and we get this really eloquent speech here that wraps up the book of Romans chapter 8, where Paul says that God will love us basically no matter what. We're going to break down these verses here for what it says. And he starts off with the two most polarizing things, basically whether we're dead or alive, that neither death nor life can separate us from the love of God. Now, here's the thing, folks. That's pretty much everything. In other words, if you're alive, you still can't be separated. Because if you're saved, the Holy Spirit of God is within you, and He is God. So God is within you if you are a believer and you're living. And because of that, not only do you have God, not only are you in the presence of God, but God is within you. You hear people talk about how they're kicking God out of this and kicking God out of that. If there's believers there, they can't kick God out of anything because God is inside the believer. So even if we aren't recognizing it publicly, it doesn't change the fact that every born-again believer in Jesus Christ has God within them, and God loves them. His gift to them is the Holy Spirit of God. And that Holy Spirit anointing of God that goes within every believer, that is a sign of God's love. But he also says that when we die, death cannot separate us from God's love. Now, in our human mind, death is the end of almost all things. Now, I know that if a close loved one dies, you don't stop loving them at death. The loved ones that I have lost, I still love very, very dearly. I think of them often, but let's be real honest. As generations go on and on and on, people begin to forget. In fact, when I used to like to go around to some of the cemeteries and write down information who was buried where. And one thing I found in the last few years, and maybe why I stopped doing it because it really bothered me, is there is some cemeteries people have forgotten. Trees are grown up in them. No one even knows they're there. So these people who were once living with loved ones and kids and children have now been forgotten, and the love that was once felt for them, that love has passed on to them. Because of that, that love has eventually been separated. But you know what? If they're a born-again believer in Jesus Christ, the absent from the body is to be present with the Lord, and they will never be forgotten in God. God doesn't leave them. God doesn't just, you know, forsake them. God loves them and welcomes them at the moment you draw your last breath, the moment your heart stops. You are with God, and you are in His very presence. You see, death and life cannot separate us from the love of God. And before I go any further, I want to clarify something here, too. We are talking about believers in Jesus Christ here. You see, we're talking about the church. When we go on, it talks about angels or principalities, and we're talking about angels and demons or fallen angels. I remember one-third of the angels of heaven followed Satan and was kicked out of heaven. And those are your demons or your dark forces today that are working the world. And these dark forces like to wreak havoc for the church. They don't wreak havoc for non-believers so much or unsaved people. And the reason that they don't is because, well, you're not a threat to them. You may be a good person, but being a good person isn't a threat to the devil. It doesn't bother the devil. But what the devil wants to do, he wants to put a muzzle on the church. We cannot be as effective. And because of that, he tries to do things to kill our testimony and kill our witness. Now, the devil cannot rob us of our salvation, no matter what he does. Our salvation is secure in the hands of God. But when we look what the devil does do, he basically just tries to destroy our witness. He tries to make us miserable, that we can't be effective for God. But yet, that doesn't change God's love. No matter where the devil takes you, God still loves you. Nothing in the present or future can take us out of the love of God. So nothing you are doing or going through now, or nothing that you're going to do or going to go through, is going to change God's love for you. Things present nor things to come. Now, here's why a lot of people I've heard preach, I don't see any truth to it myself personally. But I've heard people say, well, in this list, you don't have sin. Well, what are things present and things to come? If you're sinning, you're either going to sin in the present or sin in the future. So it's either a present thing or a future thing to come. And if neither of those can remove you from the love of God, that means even in your sinful, wretched state, God loves you. Now, a lot of people need to hear that. Because they get so beaten down on themselves when people's told them, well, you've messed up. You got saved, but God's done with you because you made a mistake along the way. Listen, that's not what the Bible tells us. The Bible tells us that these things will not separate us from God's love. It's like with my kids, now, he's going to chasten you if you do wrong. That doesn't mean he doesn't love you. It means he does love you. As my kids. My kids could burn my house down. They could smack me in the face, and I may get mad as can be at them, but I still love them. My love never changes. It never lessens because of the things they do. It doesn't change. It may bring my wrath. I will discipline them in some way that is appropriate for the situation, but I will not stop loving them. If God is your heavenly Father, he's not going to stop loving you. He will discipline you for what you have done. In fact, if God doesn't discipline you, that means he's not your heavenly Father. You're unsaved. I need to swallow that too. Because a lot of people, they have no problem committing unrepentant sin. And they don't see nothing wrong with it. Well, if you are doing that and see nothing wrong with it, the fact of the matter is you're not saved. It's point blank. There's no way around it. Because the Bible says that a father that loves his children disciplines them. That means if God is your heavenly Father and he doesn't discipline you, he would not be loving you. That's a contradiction. So if God loves you and you are sinning, he has to discipline you. But he will never stop loving you. He will always love you. Bible goes on to say, no force of any kind, in other words, not natural forces, man-made forces, may separate us from the love of God. These things separate us from the love of man. There's plenty of things that we're seeing here that man-made love would simply go away. I'm sure there's things you could do in the present or the future that make your friends stop loving you. There probably are things you could do that make your spouse stop loving you. But the very worst you can do, God will still love you if you are his child. You see, the Bible goes on to say that no distance can separate us from the love of God. It doesn't matter if you're in outer space or you're in the belly of the earth. God still loves you. In fact, not only does he love you, he knows where you are. He knows the number of the hairs upon your head. He knows everything about you because he loves you. He created you. He made you just the way he wanted to. And if this did not sort of really give us an understanding for this, and I think Paul really put this in, because you know with everything Paul is saying, I've seen it done, and I'm going to guess it was done in Paul's day, where people will say, well, but what about this? It's like I said with sin. What about sin? What about if someone does this? Will God quit loving them then? What about this? And Paul wraps up basically with this, that no kind of creation can separate us from the love of God. Now stop for just one second. Who is the creator? The creator is God. Everything besides God has been created by God. Everything. The darkness, the light, everything has been created. Which means if no creation can separate you from the love of God, that means nothing. Not even the believer can separate himself from the love of God. God's love never fails. It never gives up. It never runs out. God loves you eternally. God loves you in the past, God loves you in the present, God loves you in the future. God loved you before you were conceived in your mother's womb. God's love goes on forever. And if you are in solitude right now, maybe you don't have anybody. Maybe you have been quarantined in your house by yourself for it's hard to tell how long at this point. Let me tell you something. God still loves you just the way you are. Man, is that not awesome? Let's look at John chapter 10. Verse 28 through 29. The Bible says, this is Jesus speaking, I gave unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father which gave them me is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. So we see as Jesus is speaking here, he tells us that we was given to him by God, and he was given to us by Father God. And because of that, now here's the thing, remember, God did this, not man. You didn't give yourself to the Lord. The Lord gave you to Jesus. And as we see what Jesus is saying here, he's saying there's security there. There's a security that no one can take away your salvation. No one can take away your saved state. No one can change the fact that you're a child of God, because your salvation does not belong to anyone else. In fact, your salvation does not belong to you. It is not held in your hand. It's held in God's hand. And no one can pluck us out of God's hand. Who are we to even fathom that someone could overpower God and remove something that is God's? I feel like that is just really downgrading God so much. Let's look at the book of Malachi, chapter 1, verses 2 and 3. It says, I have loved you, saith the Lord, yet ye say, wherein hast thou loved us? Was not Esau Jacob's brother, saith the Lord, yet I loved Jacob, and I hated Esau, and laid his mountains and his heritage waste for the dragons of the wilderness. You see, God, our love is secure because God has chosen us in love and because it is anchored in Christ. The reason, this is really hard to understand, it's hard for me to understand, and that's okay, because when we think about something that goes beyond human understanding, like a love of God, it is really easy to lose track of that. But our love is anchored, or God's love for us is anchored in Christ. You see, Christ is God's only begotten Son. He's a part of the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And we are in Christ. Now, for God to not love us any longer, the church, God would have to stop loving His Son, Jesus Christ. And even as Christ went to the cross of Calvary, and God turned from him, as Jesus cried out, why hast thou forsaken me? It did not change that God loved his Son. That's why his gift of salvation is so precious, because he gave his only begotten Son, that we may have a relationship with him and have unfailing love. Let me tell you something. If you're unsaved and you're out there searching for love, maybe you're looking for a boyfriend, girlfriend, husband, wife that'll love you, let me tell you something. Put all that on the back burners. Don't even worry about that right now. Turn to God. Have a relationship with Him. Because once you experience true love through Jesus Christ, it gives you a better understanding of what love is. And because you have a better understanding of what love is, you're going to have a better relationship with the people around you. Your love is going to grow. Your love is going to be more true. Your love is going to be more genuine. Because a lot of people are going to tell you they love you that really does not love you. The book of Jude, chapter 1, verse 21 says, keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, when we see Jude preaching here, you think, well, that you just contradicted yourself. Jude says, keep yourself in the love of God. But let me explain something to you. There's a difference between being in the love of God and operating in the love of God. And what Jude is talking about here is operating within the love of God. There is, God's love is never changing. We already said it, it's inseparable. If you're a child of God, God will never stop loving you. You'll never stop being His children. But the problem is sometimes we don't remind ourselves of that enough. Sometimes, even though God loves us, we don't see ourselves through the eyes of God, and we don't allow ourselves to operate in the love of God. Because it says, looking for the mercies of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is patient and long-suffering. He is merciful and He is gracious. Which means when we sin, when we have issues, when we have problems in our life, we need to look for the mercies that are in Jesus Christ and operate ourselves within that love of God. Maybe you have a sin problem today. Maybe you feel like you have went so far away from God that there is no turning back. Let me tell you something. If you have a true relationship with God, that relationship never ends. It is eternally secure in Christ. But let me also tell you, if you don't have a relationship with God, maybe you've done all kinds of horrible things. Maybe you've been on drugs. Maybe you've lived in sin, committed adultery. Maybe you've even killed somebody. I don't know. Look at the Apostle Paul that's writing the book of Romans here. Look at what he done. He was Saul when he persecuted the church and cheered the stoning of Christians, and all these horrible things happened. But you know what? God showed up one day on Damascus Road and got his attention, and he submitted his life to Christ and was saved and born again. And God used him in a powerful way to do awesome things. And God can do the very same thing with you, no matter what you've done, no matter where you've been. See, Philippians 1:6, it says, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it unto the day of Jesus Christ. Man, what a beautiful promise Philippians will end with there. That we are confident that if God has saved you and he has begun a good work in you, that he will perform that work all the way until the end, all the way until judgment. Listen, God is not an Indian giver. God doesn't do things halfway. If God is going to save you, he's going to save you all the way. If God is going to do a work in you and progressively sanctify you, in other words, work on cleaning you up, he's not going to get you so far and just stop. He's going to continue that good work on you. If God has started a relationship with you, that relationship is not, he's not going to divorce you. He's not going to put you up for adoption and make you an orphan. You are secure in Jesus Christ. Listen, do not feel that God has abandoned you. The Bible says, he tells us that he would never leave us nor forsake us. He would go with us all the way. All the way. Listen, too many people out there today have been born again, been saved, and God is, and the only thing God wants them to do is just come to him and ask for forgiveness. See, it's not that they're unsaved, it's they're not living up to the calling God has given them. And there's also people today, as we've said before, got a good dose of religion. And that's why you see they don't have the fruits of the Spirit. They're not being loving towards others. Listen, we got a lot of time here that we're spending in solitude. I know things are starting to reopen, but I don't know if you're like me, but I'm not going anywhere just yet because I'm not convinced that I'm ready to just venture out there and risk my health for a cheeseburger or something. If it's something I need, I'd go, but I just don't need anything right now. But you know, the reality is we can do anything we want to with this time God has given us. But I made the post on Facebook last night, this morning one, that I pray that we use it to learn to love people a little bit more. I pray we use it to look at people the way Christ looks at people. I pray that we use it to be more patient and more long-suffering and more merciful and gracious with people as God is towards us. Let me tell you something. If you have never experienced true love today, I want to give you an invitation right now to turn to God and experience true eternal love. It's a love that your husband or wife cannot fulfill. It's a love that your children cannot fulfill. It's a love that no one you ever going to come around, no item, no material possession can ever fulfill. It's a love that you will only find in God. And even when you have that relationship, it's going to make all your relationships so much better. Your marriage is going to be more fulfilled. And you say, well, you just said health, wealth, and prosperity. Now, I'm not saying you won't suffer, but what I am saying, even when you suffer in your marriage, you will look at it from a biblical perspective and it won't bother you as much because God is there working through them situations in your marriage, with your kids, with your job, with your families. Listen, you need Christ. It's not a want. It's not a lighthearted decision. You need Christ because you have a sin debt that you cannot pay. And there's going to be a time come that this is all going to come to an end, either through death or through the rapture. And if you are without Christ, if you are not in Christ, you are unsaved, and you will face the wrath of God and experience an eternal hell and condemnation. That is a place of torments, a place separated from God, a place that never ends. But it doesn't have to be that way. Hell was not created for man to go to. Hell was created as a prison for the devil and those angels that chose to follow him. But the problem is too many people are choosing to follow the devil just like the angels did. And I'm not saying you're going out and having some Satan worship service, but if you are not choosing God, it's one or the other. It's either God or the devil. Who will you choose this day? Listen, Jesus Christ was sent by God to come to earth and live a sinless life, that he may die and pay the price for all mankind, that if we were simply willing to trust in him, we can have all our sins washed away, be made pure, and be in heaven with God someday, and don't have to worry about places like hell because of God's unfailing love for us. We are secure in him because we place our faith in Christ. Listen, if you've never made that step of salvation, I would encourage you as we close this morning to call out to God in faith, asking him to save you based on your faith in Jesus Christ. It's a simple prayer, folks. A simple prayer is admitting you're a sinner. Something like, Lord, I know that I've sinned. I know that I've made mistakes. I know I've messed up, Lord. I know that I have a debt I cannot pay to you, Lord. But Lord, I believe in your Son, Jesus Christ, and I trust fully in him for the payment he made on the cross. And I ask you, Lord, to save me and to come in my life. And I ask for Jesus Christ to be my personal Savior. A prayer as simple as that. Again, it's not the exact words. It's the faith of the heart. It's the belief you have, the trust you have in Christ that saves you. A prayer like that. Maybe some of you all have prayed that prayer. Maybe some of you all have been saved. You've been born again. But you're simply not really operating in your calling. You're not being where you need to be with God. You need to take this point to rededicate yourself to the service of the Lord. Rededicate yourself back to God. It doesn't mean you're getting re-saved. You just get saved once. What that means is your intimacy isn't what it should be. You need to be closer to God. And you're asking God to draw you close to him once again. You're asking God to put the fire back in your heart, give you a filling of the Spirit that not only can you be saved, but you can be effective and enjoy the joys of the Lord. So as we close out this evening in prayer, I ask you to examine yourselves and make that decision this evening. Make the decision for God. Make the decision to allow him to love you the way he so desires. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Most kind, gracious Heavenly Father, God, Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to preach your word this evening. We thank you for the love that you have for us, Lord, that we know that there is nothing but comparison. It goes beyond all understanding that you express it on the cross of Calvary when you gave up your only begotten Son to die for us, Lord, that we may have salvation, have a relationship with you. Lord, we pray for those that are hearing this message. We pray first for the unsaved, Lord, that your Holy Spirit power of conviction would fall upon them, Lord, and they would call on your name to be saved. And Lord, we pray for those that just may not be where they need to be with you, God, that you would... your Spirit would convict them. We know there's no condemnation in you, Lord, but we pray that your Spirit would convict them and that they would rededicate themselves to your service and to doing the things they needed to be close to you. Lord, we pray for revival in our community and our land, Lord, that we know can only come through and by the working of your Holy Spirit. And we pray, Lord, that you bless our services. Bless all those that are hearing, Lord, and let your will be done. In Jesus' name we pray, and amen.